desire to fly like the birds in the sky has infatuated humans since the dawn of civilization, primarily because we, as a species, are ungrateful. Through a series of unfathomably improbable accidents, humans were given things like legs and opposable thumbs and critical thinking skills, but somewhere along the line of all these cosmic coincidences, our brains were also programmed with a design flaw known as envy. See, early man envied the bird because it was up there and we were down here. So after a few dozen millennia of shouting at birds, we finally decided to figure out how to fly. When waving our arms really fast didn't work, Da Vinci tried to rectify the situation with contraptions that, frankly, probably wouldn't have worked either. The Wright brothers figured out how to pull off powered flight somewhat reliably in the early 20th century, and a scant 250 years later, mankind finally perfected the ultimate flying machine. A 70-foot-tall, bipedal, walking tank. Because robot. Fly, Gundam, fly goes the theme of the first Gundam series, and ever since, giant robots of every color, shape, and realistic usefulness have been performing aerial acrobatics hazardous to the mental health of every physics professor on the planet. But much like our ancestors shouting maniacally at the Falcon that just stole their lunch, we, what scientists call anime fans, are also ungrateful. We watch these shows and wish that we had the unending resources of a Jeff Musk or an Elon Bezos to make our own giant flying robot, regardless of silly things like aerospace regulations. That doesn't mean that we can't have our own badass flying robot, however. You could live in the suburbs and spend half a mortgage payment on a drone that you'll use twice, or you could get one of these. Which just kind of sits there, I guess. Let's face it. The reality of model making is that once the model is made, it then sits on a shelf to be admired by you, your friends, family, the date you bring over that insists on calling it a transformer, and your 7 Instagram followers. This is why posing is so important. I talked about ground poses in one of my first videos, poses that don't need a stand and are dramatic enough to make your kit stand out. But what if we want to get this kit off the ground and recreate those epic battles we see time and time again in our Japanese animes? Well, since it's 2018 and practical anti-gravity systems haven't been invented yet, you're gonna need one of these. This is a stand. A stand will allow you to pull off a striking aerial pose without pesky things like gravity getting in the way. There are many different kinds of stands, such as the Gunpla-branded action bases or, my personal favorite, Tamashii stages. They're clear, thin, durable, and typically come in packs of 3. And the best part? Virtually no assembly is required. The base you choose is really all about preference, however. Tamashii stages try to be as unobtrusive as possible and can work with a variety of kits. But there is an upper limit to the size of the model which works well with a Tamashii stage. When I was shooting video of the DM Death Scythe Hell, I had to use its scythe to prop up most of its weight when shooting these shots. A larger stand like this, the Action Base 1, is typically the better option. Last time I did one of these posing tutorials, I showed off the real grade Astray Red Frame. Still my hands-down favorite kit, value for money. Today, along with the stand we just picked out, we're gonna use something a bit different. The GNT-0000SHIA Gundam 00 Shia Quanta. Which gets about 6 seconds of screen time during Build Fighter's Tri-Island Wars, so the background video you're gonna see here, yeah, that's of the 00 Quanta. Despite its appearance, it's not actually a giant robot designed by war profiteers for mass wanton destruction. It's a toy. Canonically. In the show Gundam Build Fighters Try, which is basically Gundam Build Fighters, but worse, the Shia Quanta is indeed a model kit, built by one Shia Kojima, whose name I'm probably butchering, and based on the GNT-00000 Quanta from Gundam 00, a show with little respect for mathematical division. Because of all the zeros, you see. Math jokes. Because the show focuses on model kits that fight other model kits thanks to dubious scientific advances, the GNT-00000SHIA Gundam 00 Shia Quanta is said to have a, quote, high level of particle control capabilities. These particles being what the show calls Plavsky particles, which allow the toys to move around like Woody and Buzz. It's unconfirmed if Gundam Build Fighters is set in the same timeline as Toy Story, but the Shia Quanta does share Buzz Lightyear's knack for falling with style. In flight mode, the Shia Quanta's movement speed increases dramatically by opening something called a GN binder after it swings to the back of the plastic toy. So, how does it work? Say it with me, kids. Because the GN binder serves as a clavicle antenna pushing the Gunpla's particle control abilities to its limit. What did you think I was going to say? It also has two sword bits it can put into use in this mode, and that's not me with some cheeky wordplay, they're actually called sword bits, and I think that's adorable. It also has cat ears. Because why the hell not? Kit-wise, it's pretty good too. The entire Build Fighters high-grade line is generally solid from top to bottom, with no kits that are really offensively bad in any way. Even relatively simple kits like the Tri-Burning Gundam still have great posability and a decent amount of charm, and many make use of some great-looking clear parts, something the Shia Quanta uses extensively. While I feel the detail is somewhat lacking in places, the kit has enough color separation in its individual limbs to keep things interesting. And the swords and shields this thing has makes great use of the clear plastic I mentioned earlier. It also has cat ears. The Shia Quality Atra is plenty small enough for the Tamashii stage, but we'll be using Bandai's action-based mini for this video. So, we have our kit, and now it's time to get it Insta, Twitter, Reddit ready. So, where to begin? You'll recall from my last posing video that using human models can make for great reference for posing your kits. Thing is though, humans mostly aren't equipped with jet engines, so this leaves us with two options: using references from the show as a basis for a pose, or looking elsewhere. There's nothing wrong per se with using the show as a basis for your pose. There's nothing unique about it either. So in this case, we're going to combine different references to make a unique pose that only we could have pulled off. Or you, technically, since you're the one posing it. Let's move on. Last time, we posed our kit from the top down, but this time, we're going to work from the bottom up of the Shia Quanta. Let's look at its legs. In flight, feet and legs are going to react differently than on the ground, so working with a leaping or suspended reference is a great start. Let's take a look at some of these poses from the wonderful Senshi stock over on DeviantArt. Yes, people do still use DeviantArt for useful things, and you can check them out for yourself using the link in the description below. Notice how the feet of the subjects are almost never either parallel or perpendicular to neither the ground nor the legs. Seems like a no-brainer when you think about it, but many model builders, even experienced ones, tend to forget to pose the feet as well as the legs. Give them a slightly splayed or tilted angle to give them the illusion that they're suspended in midair. Not sure if it looks right? Next time you're at the bar, or really sitting in any high chair, look at your feet as they dangle off the floor. This should give you a sense of what to look for when positioning your kit's feet. Working upward, we get to the legs themselves. This is the area where we have the most creative freedom with an aerial pose. but it's also the most critical to get right to make an effective aerial pose. Keep in mind that these kits are not designed after things in the modern world, so it's okay to exaggerate features we see in our references to really sell the giant robot motif on display. In this shot, our reference appears to be leaping off the back wall like a very athletic human. In our case, we're going to mimic the pose by starting with the more bent of the two legs, getting it in place before working on the less bent one. The less bent leg on our left works as a sort of ignition point, in other words, the point where the energy of the aerial motion is coming from. We can emphasize this even more by exaggerating these features. Increasing the bend in the bent leg and stiffening the other just slightly while spreading them slightly further apart can evoke a greater sense of scale as well as emphasizing the motion in a more anime-like style. Be careful not to overdo it though. It's easy for you to make your kit start looking like it's just doing splits, and frankly doing them poorly. The torso, in my opinion, is the hardest part of the aerial pose. Most Gunpla have a limited range of motion in the torso, which is why crouched or bent torso poses are so difficult. To compensate, we're going to treat the reference's chest and abdomen regions as one area and try to get to an average as best we can. Using a combination of the bend in the waist and working the upper joints of the legs, we can recreate largely the same effect without having the squishy muscle tissue of a human being. Finally, the arms and head, which work largely the same way as they do with ground poses. I'm moving the arms behind the torso as well as readjusting the backpack and head to make it look like it's taking off from a launch bay. Notice how we aren't looking at things like leading lines and golden ratios and whatnot like we did in the first posing video. That's because we're working in three dimensions. For the pose to really work, all angles have to be considered. Things like the golden ratio and leading lines will come together naturally if we can pull off each part one at a time. Now that we've taken inspiration from each reference, no matter the angle we look at the finished pose, it will always appear in motion. No matter how you shoot it, you'll be able to find interesting new angles and lines to make those compelling shots. Like I always say, experimentation is key. Poring through references is going to do nothing for you if you don't grab a kit off the shelf and get to work. Keep this in mind, however. Even though mobile suits aren't bound by gravity, your kit is. Posing and reposing can wear down the strength of the kit's joints over time, causing arms and legs to weaken, especially for kits that use soft polycap parts for the joints. That's something to think about on weapon-heavy kits, especially when you're going to repose it for the 8th time this week. So take your time, find some references you like, and get to work perfecting a great pose for your own bad Gunpla. I'll see you next time. Come on.